Coming up on This Week in Computer Hardware, AMD Ryzen 7. Did they beat Intel? Hands-on with the new Raspberry Pi. New phones from Mobile World Congress. Cheap tablets. GTX 1080 prices are falling because the 1080 Ti is on the way. All that and more coming up next on TWiCH.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiCH.
Bandwidth for TWiCH is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is TWiCH, This Week in Computer Hardware, episode 404, recorded March 2nd, 2017. AMD Ryzen 7, it's here.
This episode of This Week in Computer Hardware is brought to you by BarkBox. BarkBox Paw Picks the best all-natural treats and innovative toys for your dog and ships them right to your door. To receive a free month of BarkBox with your 6 or 12-month subscription and free shipping, visit getbarkbox.com/twit. And by Grasshopper. Stay connected and run your business from your mobile phone with Grasshopper. To save $50 on your order, visit trygrasshopper.com/twit.
Welcome to TWiCH, This Week in Computer Hardware, TWiCH's weekly show that aims to bring you the most useful, most engaging, most delightful, most informative, and yes, most Ryzen-filled coverage available anywhere on the internet or around the universe. Joining me, ladies and gentlemen, a man whose eyes are bleary from air travel and benchmarking, PC Purr's Ryan Shrout.
Hello, hello. Oh, those are all accurate representations of my current state, correct.
So, the short version, if you want to get the sort of TLDR version of Ryzen 7, is that if you have been waiting for fantastic multi-core performance, you know, a Ryzen 1800X is going to deliver you like $2,000 worth of Intel multi-core performance for about a grand. Oversimplifying, yes, but fundamentally accurate. If you start looking at the less expensive processors or at specifically gaming performance, the Ryzen 7 is not as compelling. If I were being cruel, if I were being perhaps cynical, I might suggest that one of the reasons why there was no reviews available until a week after the parts had been ordered is because the gaming performance is not looking spectacular compared to the Kaby Lake processors. And while I'm feeling a little snarky, let me get out of my system. I just want to really thank Amazon for taking my money and then repeatedly telling me, delivery estimate. We need a little more time to provide you with a good estimate. We'll notify you via email as soon as we have an estimated delivery date. Thanks, Amazon. Appreciate you selling me something you said was going to ship on March 2nd. So,
I mean, it still could ship on March 2nd, right? It's still the 2nd.
It's still the 2nd.
Right. I don't know.
You are entirely full of hope and joy, which is one of the things I love about you, Ryan.
I'm counting on my Nintendo Switch being delivered tomorrow as well. So I'm still hoping that Amazon gets it together and ships that product to me. So
Shannon has been sharpening her war axe for when she goes to Best Buy to pick hers up. Best Buy assures her that it will be ready. Her Nintendo Switch will be there waiting for her, song in its heart, ready to game. And I feel bad for anyone there should it not be there when it's supposed to. I feel bad for Best Buy in general, but if it's not there. But I mean, let's talk about PC Per. Let's head over to the PC Per website. We're looking at a second ago. AMD Ryzen 7 1800X review now and Zen.
You like that?
The buildup, it's beautiful.
Thank you.
The buildup for this has been going on forever. You probably already know that the 1800X, 1700X, and 1700, we talked about it last week. They're all offering 20 megabytes of cache. They're all running 8 cores, 16 threads. Overclocking is based on the chipset, not on the part itself. So they are very enthusiast. They're supportive of the enthusiast. I don't know how else to explain it. They are power sipping compared to the Intel parts, 14 nanometer FinFET process. The power consumption is looking fantastic. We'll talk about the architecture a little bit more in a minute, but you know, you're looking at 65 watts for a $329 Ryzen 7 1700. That's pretty equivalent or targeted at price-wise, street price, at the Core i7 6900K or the Core i7 7700K. It lags significantly behind the Core i7-7700K, which is running at 4.2 gigahertz. The Ryzen 7 1700 is running at 3 gigahertz, which is problematic when you get to the fact that in single-core performance, the AMD parts are lagging the Intel parts by a huge amount, not nearly as much as we would have expected a couple years ago.
Yeah. I heard a breath. Yeah, I mean, the performance profile, so like the only one in it that was benchmarked in my review was the 1800X. Right. We have the 1700X and the 1700 that are being tested today for an updated story. You know, your summation at the beginning was pretty much spot on, right? Where the single-threaded performance was lower, and we expected it to be the case, and AMD was kind of putting that forward, and the multi-threaded performance was better, right? So if you're comparing it against the top-end Kaby Lake, you're going to win on multi-threaded apps, hands down. When you compare it to Broadwell E multi-threaded, it's going to be a mixed bag, ahead by a few points, behind by a few points, but very competitive at half the price. The biggest concern was on the gaming results, and they're the ones that were surprising. They're the ones that are, we differ in opinion on things with AMD on this, right? AMD was very much presenting benchmarks and a 4K to 2560 by 1400 resolution and quality settings. And they never really showed off 1080p results. It's kind of clear at this point why they didn't do it. The 1080p results, even though, you know, I had a discussion with somebody this morning about like why test 1080p on a high-end processor like this. And the truth is, the 1080p is still far and away the biggest, the most popular resolution for gamers. And that includes people who are running at 1080p 60, but also keep in mind 1080p 120, 1080p 144, 1080p 200 hertz, all these monitors that have higher refresh rates. Those are the types of enthusiasts and power users that are going for the higher end processors as well. So we tested at 1080p kind of ultra, very high to ultra presets, depending on what they're doing. And it was surprisingly wide gap in a couple of instances. To be fair, we only tested a handful of games. And if you go to different reviews, they're going to use different software, and that's good, right? We want to see a wider coverage sample of this type of stuff. One of the things I want to do is actually get the 1800X back in the test bed and test maybe like a dozen games and see what we get from this. But it seems clear that in some cases, the 1800X and the Ryzen processors are significantly slower than the Sandy Bridge or Broadwell E Ivy Bridge equivalents. So
it defines significantly slower.
Well, like this graph here is showing you 103 frames per second versus 135 frames per second. That's, you know, 30%. That's pretty dramatic. Much more than the 6 to 10% single-threaded performance delta that we would see otherwise, right?
Right.
And so it's concerning for that. AMD's statement that they came out with today regarding gaming performance specifically was that, you know, they kind of recognized the 1080p results, said if you're gaming at higher resolutions than that, you don't have to worry about it because the processor becomes not one of the fundamental bottlenecks for the system. And as game developers become more familiar with the architecture, they'll be able to time it, or they'll be able to work on it and kind of improve things. And there's validity to that comment, even though it may seem like a cop-out in a lot of ways, is that just by default, all developers have been running on Intel processors. When you do your performance profiling in a game engine, you're just using an Intel system. You never really cared what the AMD performance was. Now I think that needs to be...
AMD walked away from the high-end market, you know, in terms of desktop processors. So this is kind of a trap of AMD's own making. I mean, you know, is this something that we might see game developers? It would seem to me that it would require a fairly intense amount of optimization and updating to improve performance. Has anybody as a developer commented on what it will take to improve performance for the AMD processors on their games?
Not to me specifically. The only comments I've gotten have come through AMD. So you got to, you know, take that for a grain of salt, if you will. But you know, the developers of Total War series, the developers of Ashes of Singularity have talked about, we plan on optimizing the architecture. We plan on taking advantage of additional threads. But But I think it's too early for anybody to have say, we think we can get 10% out of this, or we think we can get 20% out of this if we optimize it, or there's a compiler addition or something like that. And to be fair to the critics of this stance, you know, Ryzen is launching today, but it's not a new architecture. It's not a new processor to AMD. They could have and probably should have been banging this drum with developers for a while to avoid this issue. Because what we saw is, I would say in the last 2 months, we saw the Ryzen marketing and messaging being very gaming centric to it has now shifted up until like, you know, this week being much more productivity and creation centric, right? Because as they started to realize these are the results people were giving them, and this was going to be the landscape of messaging from that point forward, that they needed to make sure they positioned it in an appropriate way. And I don't want to discount the processor. I still don't think it's a bad part. I still think it's a really good part for everything except 1080p gaming. If you're gaming at 25 by 14 or 4K, or those are your goals, or if you have a significantly lower power GPU that you plan on using for a while, then the performance is going to be fantastic. And if you do anything in the multi-threaded landscape, you know, you were talking about your video production timelines and stuff. If you do anything in that regard, you're going to see a humongous perf increase against the 7700K and a huge perf per dollar increase over the 6900K. So the AMD has an angle on both of those. It's just really unfortunate that the gaming tests that all the CPU reviews run, they've always been almost all 1080p, because that's where you want to try. Here's the thing. Before, we were actively trying to find ways to differentiate CPU performance. So you would run it at 1080p or lower at low quality presets. And even then, you would see very little differentiation between all of the Intel parts. Unfortunately, that mindset is what got us to the point where a lot of people were doing that. You know, I think I saw somebody today ran a test at like 800 by 600 at low quality settings, just so they could like get the highest possible frequency or frame rate out of it, right? And I'm thinking, well, that's a little disingenuous. But 1080p Ultra is very realistic. It's very common. And I think it's a fair thing to think. And to AMD's credit, they didn't go on a rampage talking about nobody does that, the future is 4K, blah, blah, blah. You know, they said, you know, we're competitive in those areas. We wish you would look at those. But they didn't poo-poo the idea that 1080p was important at the very least. So
this is good.
Yeah.
As people who deal a lot with video, as people who deal a lot, you know, anybody out there who is desperate for multi-threaded application performance to improve vastly, you know, you're looking at spending half as much for comparable Intel performance. And that's pretty exciting as far as I'm concerned.
Yep.
You know, and, you know, with all due respect, I'll just get a bigger monitor.
That I'm sure they're totally fine with that. They have no problem with you adjusting for that.
you know, but yeah, it's interesting, right? 1700 benchmarks, PC PERS are coming out. PC Gamer and some other websites have found some early parts to review. It's been interesting to look at that, because when you're looking at, again, you know, it's the same story, but a little more dramatic, right? Because it's sitting at a $329 point. If you're a pure gamer and you're at 1080p, you're looking, you are behind an Intel part. If you are, you know, a content creator or dealing with applications that can take advantage of 16 cores or 8 cores and 16 threads, then Ryzen starts really looking compelling for the money. You know, just keep an eye on the benchmarks, keep an eye on the games you play, and think about getting a bigger monitor to go along with your massive new system. Josh did a really good write-up on PC Per talking about the getting more in-depth on the Ryzen architecture updates. Some of the highlights are talking about the CCX modules, which essentially bundles 4 Zen cores, 8 megs of L3 cache that's pooled or shared amongst the cores. And the L3 cache is interesting because it basically copies the L1 and L2. So you don't have to worry about the CPU that's working getting interrupted by cache reads or cache read requests from the other cores. The TLB is larger, Josh writes. The branch prediction is more robust. It's got a 4-wide decoder. There's some questions about whether or not the neural net prediction functionality is actually a neural net, but it does include branch prediction, TLBs, and prefetch, 4 ALUs per core, 2 AGU or address generation units per core. Those are load store units. So 192 instructions can be in flight at any one time, writes Josh, and features an 8-wide retire. This is a big jump for AMD. And, you know, basically it's going to eliminate that as a bottleneck on throughput. The op cache basically will do some of the decoded ops, keep them locally so they don't have to be redone. The power consumption story, they worked really, really closely with Global Foundry to optimize the architecture for the 14-nanometer FinFET and really did some creative stuff with how they deliver power. Specialized capacitors in the upper metal layers are strategically placed around the design so that when the CPU is downclocked or dropping into a lower power state, these capacitors provide near instant power to these areas without the typical voltage droop we see in traditional designs. So the CPU can react really, really faster to changes in P state. And man, the power management on this is crazy. They have sensors all across the CPU. AMD says they're monitoring more than 1,300 critical paths. So when things are either clocking too fast or there's signal issues, there's literally 48 high-speed power supply monitors can report where more power is needed in parts of the core or where parts of the core are not drawing very much power. And then there's 20 thermal diodes across the die that report to the controller if the chip's heating up in a particular area or if the chip can run a little bit faster in that area because there's some thermal headroom remaining. And then there's, he writes, quote, finally, there are 9 high-speed droop detectors that help to minimize voltage droop and informs the control fabric where to increase power. So they went way over the top in trying to make this part incredibly efficient and incredibly fast in terms of figuring out, you know, where they need to throw the power and then minimizing the consumption in other areas of the chip. So I'm excited. Someday, Amazon may actually ship it to me. Until then, we wait. The other thing I'm waiting for is cooler mounts for Ryzen. Jeremy's got a nice wrap-up of what's going on. At CES, AMD was very, very... You can use your existing coolers. Noctua, for example, is so delighted that we haven't changed our architecture in years. They're going to give away the adapters for nothing. NZXT has a program where you can request a free AM4 mounting kit for your Kraken X62, X52, X42, X41, X40, X61, or Kraken X31. Those start shipping on the 15th of March, which makes me wonder if that's when I'm actually going to see my processor from Amazon. Not that I'm bitter. That said, you will have to provide proof of purchase for your AM4 motherboard and the Kraken cooler. So hopefully you still have the receipt for that. Fractal Design is doing something similar for Kelvin coolers. Scythes is doing something a little differently, writes Jeremy. If you reside in Europe, they are offering free mounting kits to owners of their Mugen 5 cooler. And then if you have a Katana 3 or 4, a Kabuto 3, a Shuriken Rev B, a Tatsumi A, Byakko, or Lori cooler, your cooler mount apparently is already compatible. And then everybody else needs to order a bracket. So
Corsair
is also working on getting their brackets in, and several other cooler manufacturers are working furiously to make them available.
We had an issue arise here, like the Corsair H110, the way it mounts to the motherboard works with the current AM3 platforms. Like, you know, basically you don't have to change the backplate on the board to use that particular Corsair cooler, but the H115 you do, and because of that, because the actual posts that come through the motherboard a little bit different, that didn't work. So of course, like, it's one of those things, half of Corsair's coolers work and half of them don't, more or something to that effect, which is, you know, a confusing state to be in for sure. So I still have yet to install a water cooler on one of these platforms, which is what I really want to do, obviously. So
I am patiently waiting for a liquid cooler to come in to use so I can overclock the snot out of mine when it gets here. So One last thought before we thank one of our sponsors on today's episode. If you've been pining for an Oculus Rift, the price has just dropped. Pretty significantly, actually. The Rift headset and touch controller are each dropping $100, so the total cost is down from $800 to $600, or if I'm told correctly, $598. You'll still need a PC to run that, but if you have a PC, such as an AMD Ryzen-based PC, you should be good to go on that one. Sony, also in that Business Insider article, Sony says they've sold 925,000 PlayStation VR headsets already, which, according to analysts, means that Oculus is probably way behind both Sony and the HTC Vive, which to me says never underestimate the importance and power of a good controller when you're marketing a VR headset. So, and again, lots of speculation about whether or not anybody's actually buying these and what the future of it is, but it is all very, very early. So we wait, ladies and gentlemen, with bated breath, as always, to find out the future.
As we often do, yes.
Because there's just no choice on that one. All right. Let's take a moment to say hello to our friends over at BarkBox. This episode of This Week in Computer Hardware is brought to you by BarkBox. BarkBox delivers 4 to 6 natural treats and fun toys for your dog, curated around a surprise theme each and every month. BarkBox Paw picks the best all-natural treats and innovative toys to match your dog's unique needs, including allergies. And if you got a heavy chewer, they got you covered. All the edibles in the box are made in the USA or Canada, and 100% of their products are tested on animals, their own. They want to keep your pets safe. They're not throwing delete expletive from terrible places into the box. They are on top of it. I love that. BarkBox is a great way to try a variety of treats and toys from local and small businesses that you might not be able to find nearby. What's nice is that BarkBox, they make their own paw dogs through their Bark & Co. brand. They've shipped over 60 million toys and treats so far, and you can find the stuff you get in the box up on their website. So easy to get started. You pick your dog size, small and cute, up to 20 pounds, just right, 20 to 50 pounds, or big and bold, that's for 50-pound and larger dogs. You choose a plan. 1, 6, or 12-month plans are out there. And then you get your BarkBox. They're shipped on the 15th of each month. BarkBox is going to keep your dog engaged, interested, and happy. If your dog doesn't like something in BarkBox, they'll send you something else for free. Scout's honor. And when your dog falls in love with something from the box, like I said, you can easily find it again on BarkShop.com or the BarkBox app, so you can keep your puppers happy and sated with delightful new treats. You can cancel anytime. Shipping is free in the continental United States. Give your dog the joy of a million belly scratches. Get 1 month free and free shipping with your 6 or 12 month subscription by visiting getbarkbox.com/twit. That's getbarkbox.com/twit. And we want to thank BarkBox for their support. Oh my goodness. So interesting round of releases at Game Developers Conference this week. Most notably for the hardware enthusiast community is that the 1080 GTX, NVIDIA's 1080 GTX, is dropping in price to $499, probably because NVIDIA announced the GeForce GTX 1080 Ti, an 11 gigabytes graphics card, $699, available next week. And I suspect you will soon be able to read a full review of that card on PC Per.
Yeah, it's next week. No, I just got
wicked, Ryan.
No joking. I got the card in. I don't have a driver, of course. You know, all the normal things that occur with this, with these types of releases. It's a pretty impressive looking product, the 1080 Ti. So it's GP102 based, essentially the same chip that was on the Pascal based Titan X that launched. I didn't realize this. That Titan X launched back in August of 2016. So it's been out for, you know, a good while now, you know, 5, 6, 7 months. Yeah, that we're up to on this. You have the same CUDA core count, 3584. The clock speeds are higher on the 1080 Ti. So your theoretical peak throughput is better. One of the interesting changes to this is that the memory, so they've worked with Micron. Micron has faster G5X memory chips now. So now the memory on the 1080 Ti is going to run at 11 gigabits per second instead of 10 gigabits per second. But the frame buffer, the memory capacity of this card is 11 gigabytes compared to 12 gigabytes on the Titan X. And the reason it's 11 gigabytes is if you look at that specs table, the memory interface there is 352 bits, which is an odd sounding number. But if you think about it, it is one 32-bit chunk less than 384. So essentially what they did was they took one of the 12 32-bit memory interfaces, disabled it to improve yield, improve cost, whatever you want to look at it as. And thus there were 11 memory controllers. It made more sense to make it even 1 gig per controller. Thus, you get 11 gigs of memory, an odd capacity to be sure, but still plenty for 4K and into 5K gaming. Memory bandwidth still remains basically the same because of the smaller interface, but the higher clock speed. You're about 4 gigabytes per second higher on the 1080 Ti than you are on the Titan X. And then they're tweaking the process some, bending the chips a little bit better, so they're 220 watt TDP instead of 250 watt TDP. But everything else kind of remains the same. The price, though, is great at $699. It's, you take that how you will, right? I don't recommend everybody go buy a $700 GPU. But compared to the Titan X that was released at $1,200, yeah, it does. And my estimate before they announced the price on Tuesday was $799. And several other people, that it were in our group, as we were waiting for this announcement to occur, had it at $899. So we were all, overselling the price, which was good for consumers, right? And along with this, the price drops of the 1080 and, probably 1070 and 1060 as well, even if they didn't really officially discuss it. So it's an iteratively better product for sure. It's not a revolutionary thing, but if you go to the next slide down, that's their performance estimates at a bunch of games you can't read along the bottom. Comparing the 1080 to the 1080 Ti, and they're talking about, about 35% faster on average compared to the GTX 1080.
Nice.
So that's pretty good considering. So now it's a $200 delta to move up to that. The only other little quirk to the card, if you look at that shot right there with the display output connectivity, it does not have a DVI port on it. And all the 10 series cards did before, all the 9 series cards did before that. So this is a little bit different for them, but they needed that extra space for cooling to exhaust the air out of the vapor chamber in there. They do include a DisplayPort to DVI adapter in the box for the Founders Editions. But I have not gotten an answer yet on whether or not those are single link or dual link yet. The other point is the Founders Edition is going to be selling for the same... is going to be selling for that MSRP. Remember the 1080, 1070, 1060, they were like $50 more or $60 more than the kind of add-in card base price, which caused a lot of issues up front where, nobody really thought those should be considered the real MSRPs because we didn't see cards at that price point for a very long time. So they're addressing that by, launching these Founders Edition / reference designs at the same $699 window that their partner cards will be, set to bottom out at in that regard. So it's pretty good, right? Like it's preparation for whatever AMD's Vega part happens to become in the next, 3, 4, 5 months. And it's going to be a hard sell for AMD to really cross that. And, we'll see what they have to do in terms of pricing and performance once we get closer to that. But this looks to be an impressive card. So next week, the reviews will be out. I don't know if they say exactly what day, so I'm not going to say what day. End of the week, we'll say. How about that? Yeah.
Sounds like a plan. NVIDIA Fat Cat, or F-Cat, sorry. Every time I see F-Cat, I want to say Fat Cat. Preview of a new performance tool. Ryan notes in the article that virtual reality hasn't taken off with the momentum that many in the industry had expected on the heels of the HTC Vive and Oculus Rift launches last year, but it does remain one of the fastest growing aspects of PC hardware. And it also pushes hardware, I think, more viciously than anything we've seen in a long, long time.
which brings us to figuring out how to measure the performance. What's going on with FCAT?
So if it was hard for me to fathom this. The original FCAT came out in 2013, which is where we used hardware capture technology to monitor, to capture the display that would be going out to the monitor, right? We intercept it, and then we measure performance based on those captures. So it's a much more reliable, complete way to evaluate the actual experience somebody gets. With VR, it's incredibly complicated, both because capturing it was very difficult. It was difficult because the software, like you have to have a piece of software that adds a little colored bar to the side of the screen. If you scroll down just a little bit in like the capture image you see there, those colored bars on the left and right aren't in the game. They're part of a third party piece of software that we run that changes those colors every time a frame is drawn so that we can then measure, were the colors in the right order? Was it one color per frame? Was it, multiple frames per color? Like those types of things we can measure. But the software stack in VR is way more complicated because you have the first render. It goes into a VR runtime that does all these modifications to it. They may warp it. They may adjust its spacing and sizing. And then it gets rendered one more time in the GPU before it goes out through to the display. So new software had to be written for this. And as it turns out, the new FCAT VR tool is going to allow people who just listen to this show normally or read PCPro.com normally to get the same access to data because you don't have to have hardware capture. You don't have to have post-processing capability. NVIDIA was able to write the tool so that it pulls all of its data from the open APIs and SDKs from Oculus and Steam VR. So we'll be able to measure frame rates and drop frames and warped frames. And, as you can see there, like some of the data that we'd be able to create from it is, an unconstrained FPS. One of the things that we like to look for is, because the VR headsets run at a static 90 Hertz refresh rate with VSync on, if a GPU has, if you have something like a 1080 Ti and you have a 1070 and you compare them and they both run this game at 90 frames per second, what does that tell you? It just tells you that those games, those cards can both play that game at 90 frames per second. But what it doesn't tell you is, well, how much headroom do you have in that graphics card compared to the other for a newer game or an updated game or higher image quality settings, those types of things. So unconstrained FPS tells you what FPS you would be able to get if you didn't have this 90 Hertz limit, right? Just basically looking at the GPU render times and that type of stuff. So, we'll be able to tell some of that, get better comparisons. And basically what I have done over the last several months is validate that software tool works with the hardware capture side. And thus we can reliably use the software capture tool to tell our performance stories going forward. So that'll be something mid to late March where all that comes out. But the tool will be great. And it's important to note, like this FCAT was hard to do before. This is still not easy, but you don't have to have external hardware and several thousand dollars worth of capture hardware to get it done. You'll be able to run this like you run Fraps on your PC and get data out of it and share it and communicate. And, it will be a much more diverse collection of results that we'll be able to start talking about as just a community in and of itself.
Interesting.
Yeah.
On our game developer conference theme for this block of this week in computer hardware, AMD's unveiled the next generation GPU branding and details. Radeon RX Vega. Yeah. You feeling that? Ken's got the write-up on PCPro.com. AMD this time has decided to embrace the code name for the retail naming scheme for upcoming graphics cards featuring the new GPU, the Radeon RX Vega. So couple details in there along with the naming, which quite frankly I could care less. I just want to see it's ridiculously fast and cheap because that's the way I roll. But took a look at the high bandwidth cache controller. Some of that was revealed in the Vega architecture preview at CES, but they gave a demo of the technology in action, which, the HBCC allows Vega GPUs to address all the available memory in the system.
NVMe SSD, system DRAM, network storage. Quote, AMD claims by using the already fast memory you have available on your PC to augment onboard GPU memory, such as HBM2, they will be able to offer less expensive graphics cards and ultimately offer access to much more memory than current graphics cards, which is a good theory.
The yes.
demo they showed, which is, of course, pretty favorable to AMD, the Deus Ex Mankind Divided. Vega GPU with 2 gigabytes of VRAM and a Ryzen CPU. They turned HBCC on, and they were able to show a 50% increase in average frames per second and a 100% increase in minimum frames per second, which is a big deal. That said, you're probably never going to see a Vega card with 2 gigabytes, but now that we know that NVIDIA is rolling with 11 gigabytes and the memory wars, I assume, will continue either to climb, or HBCC will demonstrate that you don't necessarily need to put all of the gigabytes on the GPU, because the GPU memory is pretty expensive. So we'll see.
Agreed.
Rapid pack math was demonstrated. So they're using half precision FP16 shaders instead of FP32 shaders. That allows them to get more performance out of the same number of GPU cores. It's interesting stuff. So Vega is coming hot on the heels of the 1080 Ti, which I may be exaggerating slightly, but I have high hopes. We've been joking around on Tech Thing for a couple of weeks about the dearth of new Android tablets. And at Mobile World Congress this week, Samsung announced a couple new tablets. And at GDC, Lenovo announced a couple of new tablets. The Tab 4 and the Tab 4 Plus, 8-inch and 10-inch. There's an optional kids pack, which, of course, involves making it harder to break and adds a blue light filter on there. And so finally, the Amazon Fire HD has a bit of competition. And there's a productivity pack for the 10-inch tablet, which includes a Bluetooth keyboard and a matching case, so you can feel all businessy. Pretty simple, we'll talk about what a $120 Android tablet delivers in a second, because Shannon took a look at one on Tech Thing this week. But the Tab 4 models, 1280 by 800 displays, Snapdragon 425 processors, 2 gigabytes of RAM. Remember that 2 gigabytes of RAM, 16 or 32 gigabytes of storage, 5 megapixel rear cameras, 2 megapixel front shooters. Tab 4 Plus, it's looking a lot more compelling, 1920 by 1200, Snapdragon 625, 3 gigabytes of RAM, 64 gigabytes of storage, and fingerprint readers. I understand the Plus models were available for demos at Mobile World Congress. These aren't going to ship until May, but the 4 series tablets are $109 and $149, depending on if you get the 8 or the 10-inch, and the Plus versions are $199 and $249. So this is really compelling, and apparently they're also working on a fresh Windows 10 tablet, which sounds pretty awesome. I bring that up because we looked at the Dragon Touch X10, which is one of the big selling Android tablets right now on Amazon.com. And if you read, this is one of those classic Amazon product names: Dragon Touch X10, 10-inch, 16-gigabyte octa-core tablet with 5-megapixel camera and Android 5.1 Lollipop. We're a little concerned about what the level of security on this will be over time, because Android 5.1 Lollipop is already more than a little old, long in the tooth. But it's $120. It's got 1 gigabyte of RAM, which is really obvious when you're trying to switch between multiple applications. It's a little emotionally traumatic. 1366 by 768 is not bad for a 10-inch screen. It's essentially, 720p-ish. It's totally workable. But the screen itself is plastic. And even during the gentle handling during our test period, I think Shannon managed to get a scratch on that. So, you can kind of tell where they cut corners. The camera, as you would expect, a 5-megapixel camera on an inexpensive tablet is atrocious. So you're not taking photography with it. If you want to consume content, it's great. If you want to run multiple apps, it's iffy. The octa-core processor, I think it would have been nice if it had been quad-core with a whole bunch more system RAM on that. I think would have helped it out. But the display looked actually really, really good. 10-point multi-touch technology. No 5 gigahertz Wi-Fi. So, You know, if you're running 5 gigahertz in your house, that could be problematic, but not bad for $120. But I'm really, really looking forward to see to seeing what the Lenovo tablets look like when those ship in May. So, should you be looking for an inexpensive tablet?
Interesting.
Yeah. This episode is brought to you by Grasshopper. Grasshopper is a virtual phone system designed for entrepreneurs. It's good stuff, people. Works like a traditional phone system, but requires no hardware purchase. It's great. You're saving money right there. They got an iOS and Android app, so callers can reach you wherever you are on your mobile phone. You get to keep your existing number so you can maintain your brand. And when you make a call, your client sees your Grasshopper caller ID instead of your personal phone number. So, you know, you got a layer of abstraction there. I like that. Simply select a toll-free or local number. You record a custom greeting, add multiple extensions for your business, and you are good to go. Toll-free numbers, you probably know, great for marketing. They make your business sound more professional. You can set up department and employee extensions, custom call forwarding to any phone in the world. So if you have a whole bunch of people in a whole bunch of places, Grasshopper is ready to make you seem like you're all in one big building, someplace important. It's awesome. Voicemails can be emailed to you as audio attachments. You can send and receive SMS and text messages from your business number. Do yourself a favor. Join the over 250,000 Grasshopper customers today. Plans are cheap. They just start at $12 a month. You got a 30-day money-back guarantee. Turn your smartphone into a business line with Grasshopper. To save $50 on your order, go to trygrasshopper.com/twit. That's trygrasshopper.com/twit. And we want to thank Grasshopper for their support of This Week in Computer Hardware. I love looking like a big company without spending giant amounts of money. It appeals to
me. It's always a plus.
It's always a plus. Oh, my goodness. Raspberry Pi Zero W came out. Five-year anniversary of the release of the Raspberry Pi. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the Pi Zero W. You may be wondering, how is it different from the original Pi Zero? And basically, they've added the wireless capability from the Raspberry Pi Model 3. So 802.11n, Bluetooth 4.0. And other than that, it is essentially the exact same Pi Zero. But if you have been looking to do sort of an embedded Raspberry Pi device that has wireless connectivity, this is a big plus because you won't have to use a whole bunch of dongles to attach wireless to this, right? Because it's got micro USB for power, micro USB for any of your USB devices, and mini HDMI. You can't even see it on there. It's so small. But when you start plugging, you'll need a dongle unless you have a mini HDMI cable, micro USB, micro USB. You start ending up with scads of cable sticking out of the side of this. GPIO compatible. A lot of potential for embedded devices with this. I was hoping for a processor upgrade. It's still running the same 1 gigahertz processor. It's essentially like the Model A, the original Raspberry Pi. But the wireless is a welcome addition, and I think we'll probably see some really, really cool embedded projects working with this. Price has gone up now to $10, which makes it $1 more expensive than Next Thing Co.'s chip PC, which also has embedded or Wi-Fi on board. But the chip PCs require you to add a $15 DIP module if you want to do VGA or HDMI output. So something to think about on that. And as if there wasn't enough hardware news this week, Mobile World Congress took place. My pick of the bestest thing at Mobile World Congress, I think. The more I think about it, the more I am obsessed with the Nokia 3310. Nokia's brand has been licensed.
No.
Oh, yeah. Yep. HMD has licensed the Nokia brand, and they are bringing back the 3310. Battery standby for up to a month, four colors to choose from. Play the classic snake game, because I know people are missing that in a horrible and desperate way. 49 pounds. The new Nokia 3310 takes the iconic silhouette of the original and reimagines it for 2017. Yeah.
Sure.
New user interface, 2.4 polarized and curved screen window makes for better readability in sunlight. I just am completely amused by this. They're saying it'll sit in standby for up to a month, all day talk times. And they've managed to bury the camera specs pretty low on this page because it's a 2-megapixel camera with LED flash for, they say, simple snaps. Also, it's 2G connectivity, so.
16 megabytes.
I know Sebastian was really smitten with this product as well. I thought I had read that it wasn't going to even work in the U.S. It didn't support the right frequencies, but I think he corrected me on that. Oh, okay. Well, I mean, it's a 3310. That's what you get, right? Like, that's what it should be. I already saw that you could play Snake on it, and that's fine. That's it.
Oh, my goodness. What else?
I kind of wanted, like, the little antenna nub at the top of it, though.
Like, yeah, that would have been...
Really, really cement the style if you're going to go for it.
If you're really going to go for it, go for it. Man, the... it makes me laugh. I don't know what else to say. BlackBerry Mobile, of course, has the Key One. It is all about bringing the keyboard back to the Android platform. Nokia has a series of inexpensive phones, the 3, the 5, and the 6. You know, the Nokia 6 has the latest version of Android. The 3 and the 5 are sort of their essential and mid-range phones, and expect those to be priced accordingly. LG's back with the G6, and for me, the big thing behind the G6 is that they have way backed away from all of the aggressive stuff they did with the LG G5. They don't have a bunch of crazy modules on this one. What they do have is a crazy screen ratio, 18:9, which to most of us out here would be 2:1, because they're claiming that the vast majority of smartphone usage is done vertically, not horizontally. So they went for a widescreen that's fairly narrow and an aluminum construction. So, you know, if you go to like the second thing down on the web page when you open up the G6 web page is, you know, 5.7-inch display and an attractive sleek phone that fits in one hand. So the 18:9 format gives them an 80% body to screen ratio, so they can fit what is essentially a phablet sized 5.7-inch display, as long as you don't mind the ratio being a little peculiar. In a fairly narrow phone. But that also means that a lot of your content will have to be rendered to fit that or will have bars. I hear Netflix is going to render to theirs. They're claiming they have Dolby Vision support in the phone, QHD plus resolution. I'll be really, really curious to see it. Dual 13 megapixel rear cameras, one of which is another wide angle camera, 125 degree angle. That looks really, really compelling. I'm hoping it works better than the camera on, let's say, the V20. IP68 rating, so it's essentially lightly waterproof, A10G standards. So, you know, in theory, it should be more difficult to break by dropping, which is a big plus. And it'll be one of the first phones with Google Assistant built in. So these are all pretty compelling. Sony's kind of came out of nowhere with Xperia XZ Premium, which I suspect is going to cost a small fortune, but if you have been looking for the ultimate smartphone camera experience and you are not particularly compelled by wide angle, the sensor in this promises to be really amazing. I'm a little concerned about the battery life because it's got a 4K display. Whenever we've seen 4K or quad HD displays on a cell phone, that's usually come at the expense of battery life. But the design is gorgeous. You know, they are claiming, you know, essentially like the V20, they're talking about having premium or over-the-top sound that'll support high-resolution audio. The camera, though, I think is really kind of the big thing on this one. And there's some breakdown shots, right? 19-megapixel motion-eye camera with super slow motion, like 960 frames per second slow motion. 5.5-inch 4K HDR display, water-resistant, and a Snapdragon 835 processor. USB-C charging and connectivity. So Sony hopefully will figure out a way to become a big player because they're making some beautiful phones. And Motorola was out with the new G5, Moto G5 and G5 Plus. So
gotcha.
Lots to look at in the Android world over the next couple months. I'm really, I like what Motorola has been doing with the mid-range phones. And I'm pleased that Lenovo is kind of continuing to debut what look like really, really good devices. Full HD displays on the Moto G5 and G5 Plus, 5 inches and 5.2 inches.
kind of make it easier to fit in your hand. The design looks really, really smooth. Metal chassis on that one. This is another Android phone that's going to be running Marshmallow and including Google Assistant. G4 Plus was notable for actually having a camera that wasn't a nightmare. G5 Plus is packing a 12-megapixel camera, f1.7 aperture, 1.4 micron pixels, dual autofocus pixels, PDAF. It's all looking really, really good. And the G5 has a 13-megapixel camera with a not-so-dark room-friendly f2.0 lens. So, and then the selfie cameras are basic 5-megapixel cameras. G5 is going to have a Snapdragon 430, and the G5 Plus is going to have the Snapdragon 625, which may sound familiar if you remember a couple of tablets from Lenovo we were talking about earlier in the show. So, lots more to look forward to this.
I would say spring. In the future, I'd prefer it if GDC and Mobile World Congress were not on identical weeks.
Yes.
Just from a personal standpoint.
Have to have your sleep removed.
Yeah.
Abandon your family. Exactly. It's all easy at that point, man. For all of our older episodes and for information on how to subscribe to the show, go to twit.tv/twitch. And as always, ladies and gentlemen, you can find more of Ryan Shroud at PC Pro. You can find more of me at techthing.com or AVXL. And we hope to see you each and every week. We welcome your hardware questions because I suspect there's going to be a dearth of hardware news next week. Outside of the 1080 Ti launch. So feel free to hit us up with your hardware questions, especially if you're thinking about building a new PC after seeing the launch of the AMD Ryzen. I suspect we'll get a lot of questions in that area. Hey, thank you so much for listening. I'm Patrick Norton.
I'm Ryan Schrell.
See you next week on Twitch.